everybody, and welcome back to SFF 180. It is Monday morning, November the 11th, and time once again for the mailbag. I hope you guys have had a great week and a great weekend. Mine was really good. I feel really good about it. It was a very productive week. I have three videos that I recorded over the weekend, including this one, and a couple of new reviews. One of which is my review for Thanksgiving, my Turkey Day review, which I mentioned last week would be a classic. And that is actually going to be up on the site, on the channel for my Patreon people this week. So you Patreon people are going to get really early access to that for change. hope you guys enjoy that. If you're not a Patreon supporter, maybe time to consider it. It's $2 a month, and basically I use the money to pay my thumbnail artist, guy who does all my wonderful thumbnails, Matt Olson. Very gifted artist, I'm very lucky to have him, and so that's what that's for. Otherwise, I don't really have a whole heck of a lot in the way of announcements, except to say that I have firmed up and committed myself to planning for Con Zealand, the Worldcon in Wellington, New Zealand. It's going to be very, very exciting. It's going to be the biggest trip I've made in quite a long time, and I have been speaking with a lot of other SFF booktubers about this. We're trying to coordinate plans of, you know, what kind of stuff we want to do, touristy-wise, and you know, just general convention plans. So there will be some folks going to this. Not everybody is 100% committed yet, obviously, because it's, you know, it's a big endeavor. It's, you know, for a lot of folks, it's going to require making sure they can get the time off of work and can budget for it. But yeah, you know, Con Zealand will be a place where there will at least be some BookTube SFF presence. And as for your own support of that, even if you're not going, supporting memberships, remember, those are a thing, and those are very important, and of course, it allows you to nominate and vote in the Hugos. If you are ready to start seeing BookTubers making inroads on the Best Fancast category, if you would like to see SFF 180 or any other BookTube channel, BookTube SFFer, well, you know, that's entirely up to you, that you guys are the ones who have that power. But it requires getting a supporting membership. Supporting memberships are 75 New Zealand dollars, which translates to about $47 and change US. That is commensurate with supporting membership rates for most past Worldcons, recent past Worldcons. So, you know, it's all in the ballpark. But I'm going to go ahead and leave that link for Con Zealand registration below, and I'm going to start leaving it now, because what they did in Dublin was, it turned out that only if you were somebody who had gotten a membership prior to the end of the year were you allowed to nominate in the Hugo. Some people who joined the convention after, you know, the 1st of January realized that they weren't allowed to do that, so it's important to do it early. Enough yammering. Good haul this week. Good size mailbag. So, hopefully this is going to bring some of you back checking out the new books, and so let's see what they are, shall we? All right, going to start out with a couple of Macmillan titles. Well, it looks like we're starting off with a bang. This is a book coming out, let's see, it says February, from Tor Books. This is an ARC for a book called Black Leviathan, and it is by an author named Bernd Purplis, I guess. I'm going to mangle that pronunciation. But he is a German author. This is a work in translation. This book has already been up for and has won at least one award over in Europe. And now it is being translated and delivered to us here in the States to enjoy. This is a Moby Dick retelling with dragons, or perhaps a dragon, the titular Black Leviathan, sounds like. Let's go ahead and read up on it a little bit. It says, in the city of Skargakar, one of those. Residents make a living from hunting dragons and using them for everything from clothing to food. Lian does his part, carving the Kyrillian crystals that power the hunting ships through the Cloud Sea. But when he makes an enemy of a dangerous man, Lian ships out on the next vessel available as a dragon hunter. But his new captain hunts more than just any dragon. His goal is the firstborn gargantuan, and Adaron is prepared to sacrifice everything for revenge. So there you see. All right. And so in February, Black Leviathan, Moby Dick in the skies with a dragon. And next up, also from Tor, we have this one from Tor Teen. This is the finished copy of Naomi Kritzer's Catfishing on Catnet. Now, this is an expansion of a short story of hers that I believe got some Hugo recognition, or I think at least a nomination, a couple of years back, called Cat Pictures, Please. And, well, it comes out a week from tomorrow, November the 19th, and it is all about this. Let's see, it's centered on the same AI protagonist featured in her acclaimed short story, Cat Pictures, Please, which won, okay, there we are, it won the 2016 Hugo and Locus Awards for Best Short Stories, and was a 2015 finalist for The Nebula. Got it, all right. Kritzer pens a thought-provoking near-future YA thriller that explores issues of online privacy, artificial intelligence, and the power and perils of social networks. Steph hasn't lived any place longer than 6 months. Her only constant is an online community called CatNet, a social media site where users upload cat pictures, a place she knows is welcome. She is welcome. What Steph doesn't know is that the admin of the site, Cheshire Cat, is a sentient AI. When a threat from Steph's past catches up to her, and Cheshire Cat's existence is discovered by outsiders, it's up to Steph and her friends, both online and in real life, to save her. A heartfelt novel that features a diverse cast of characters and a protagonist on the autism spectrum. That could not be timelier as Kritzer explores how we make connections and friendships in an increasingly fragmented society, and it comes out on the 19th from Tortine, Catfishing on CatNet. Yeah, I think that one looks really clever. Actually, this one is from HarperCollins. This is one I'm really pleased to see. This is a book called The Puzzler's War. It's by E.L. Kless, and it is the sequel to The Lost Puzzler, which is a book that came out well back in January, and I really wanted to read it in a timely fashion, and then I think it's one of those that fell victim to my really bad spring reading slump that I think I might have whined about on that video last week. I was talking about all my problems. But anyway, I am planning to catch up with these because this is out now, and in fact, I'm going to be taking Lost Puzzler, and this one with me when I go on Thanksgiving vacation here in a couple of weeks. But the sequel comes out February the 4th, and it says, "This speculative adventure explores what happens when the secrets are finally unlocked and technology long since buried once again finds its way into the hands of mankind." Kless, a professional violinist by trade, writes with the style of a great musician, layering the various plot lines together into a fantastic symphony. The second book in the Tarakan Chronicles duology, reminiscent of Mad Max Fury Road by way of the Canterbury Tales. An unlikely combination, but one that makes more and more sense the deeper into Kless's multifaceted world you get. Interesting. Okay, it's an intriguing futuristic dystopian story. Sent on a dangerous mission with little hope of succeeding, the man known as Twinkle Eyes has beaten the odds and, done things in the first book that I can't spoil here. Okay, and now his adventures continue. But The Puzzler's War, sequel to The Lost Puzzler. This will be out on February the 4th, so hopefully maybe in early December, look for a review of The Lost Puzzler and this one from me. Next up is something a little different, and in fact, I didn't even think that it was a book coming to me for the mailbag, in fact, because it came in an Amazon package. And then I sort of like dusted off my brain cobwebs a little bit and remembered that I do believe I have been in contact either in email or in like Twitter DMs with the writer on this one. I think this is one that the writer has sent me. So I apologize if I have like forgotten you in the wake of recent weeks and everything. But in any event, the book is called Girl of Fire. As you see, the author is someone named Gabrielle Mathieu. And it appears to be a book in a series called Baroness Quest. I'm going to assume it's the first book. Looks like an indie self-published fantasy epic. Let's have a look, see what it's all about. I'm going to guess it's available now. 18-year-old Barona only wants to roam free in the hills while she daydreams of a suitor who would dance with her until the night the water demon hunts her down to save her family from the demon's she dreams of this, and then one day, it's not like she wants to dance with the guy until she gets hunted down by a water demon. Those are two separate events. Got it, Thomas. Good. To save her family from the demon's threats, she flees with a heretic magician, convinced that Barona is the prophesied Girl of Fire. He promises to train her in the skills she will need to defeat their ancient enemy. Their journey is fraught with challenges, and Barona questions her destiny. How can she be the Girl of Fire when she has yet to wield a sword? But the water demon doesn't fight with swords. All right. Well then, weren't expecting that, were you? She corrupts your very soul. As alliances crumble, the demon infiltrates Barona's circle of trusted fighters and friends. Steeling herself against her broken heart, fearing the traitor within her ranks, Barona vows to prove the prophecy is her destiny. Okay, you know, it sounds like Chosen One stuff. But, you know, it's all in the telling, right? Girl of Fire by Gabriel Mathieu. Like I said, a small press book, I assume, available now. And next up, we have a really nice thick package from Simon & Schuster. Well, okay then, this is nice to see. This is Neil Schusterman's The Toll, which is the final volume in a trilogy beginning with Scythe and Thunderhead. This is a YA trilogy. The third book, The Toll, it's a fat one, is available now. Looks like it came out the 5th, so it came out last week, apparently. All right, then, it's the pulse-pounding conclusion to the Ark of a Scythe trilogy. And it says, let's see, what can I say without being spoilery? Okay, nothing. But I do know that on BookTube, these books have been very well received by readers. So, you know, maybe it's time for Thomas to catch up. I mean, I got the first two. I'm looking at them right there on a top shelf. But Neil Schusterman's The Toll, finishing out his trilogy, is available now from Simon & Schuster. Oh, my goodness. Here is another, yet another thick package from Simon & Schuster. And in that package, there are two arcs for upcoming YA titles from Simon & Schuster. The first of these is Heart of Flames. This is the very thick, like 600-page sequel to a book that came out earlier this year called Crown of Feathers, which I believe Connor O'Brien read and reviewed that one. They sent it to me. I didn't get around to it, but Connor read it and reviewed it, and I think he liked it pretty well. But Heart of Flames comes out in February, apparently. Let's see. Is there anything apart from, you know, just February the 11th? So what can I say in synopsis? You are a daughter of queens. The world is balanced on the edge of a knife, and war is almost certain between the Empire and the Phoenix Riders. Okay, so you get that sort of thing where it's going to be a big, big, grand-scale epic fantasy with battle scenes and that sort of thing. But Heart of Flames, February the 11th by Nikki Palpretto. And next in the same package, we have what appears to be an arc for the very first YA fantasy novel by Sarah Gailey, who wrote American Hippo and then Magic for Liars. And this is called When We Were Magic. And let's see, it comes, I believe, this one says March the 3rd. Keeping your magic a secret is hard. Being in love with your best friend is harder. Alexis has always been able to rely on two things, her best friends and the magic powers they all share. Their secret is what brought them together, and their love for one another is unshakable, even when that love is complicated. Complicated by problems like jealousy or insecurity or lust or love. Okay? That unshakable, complicated love is one of the only things that doesn't change on prom night. Where are we going with this? This sounds potentially very dramatic. When accidental magic goes sideways and a boy winds up dead, Alexis and her friends come together to try to right a terrible wrong. Their first attempt fails, and their second attempt fails even harder. Left with the remains of their failed spells and more consequences than anyone could have predicted, each of them must find a way to live with their part of the story. Okay, so I guess you have, you know, this group of girls in school, and they're magical, and they kill a dude who probably had it coming anyway, and now they have to deal with that. All right. When We Were Magic. Did I say March the 11th? No, March the 3rd. March the 3rd from Simon & Schuster. This is the week for thick, fat, heavy packages full of thick, fat books. And this one is from the Hatchet Group, so probably some Orbit stuff. And this is The Burning White by Brent Weeks. Yep, Angela at Orbit had one of these arcs left and decided to go ahead and send it to me. They weren't sending out finished copies with this one, so she said, I can send you this, though, and I'm like, cool, because this is the fifth and final volume in his Lightbringer massive epic fantasy series. This sucker's, you know, 900 pages if it's, you know, if it's one. And, well, The Burning White came out on the 22nd of October. And if you follow Brent Weeks and if you follow his series, well, then you are well aware now that this one is out and you're probably enjoying it. If you are enjoying it, if you're a fan of this series, if you've read the Lightbringer books, then by all means, let us all know what you what your thoughts are in the comments. But this one is out now. And yeah, maybe I'll find time to dig into this tome, hopefully soon enough. Okay, getting down to the end of all of this. This is in from Random Penguin. And this is an arc for Cyber Shogun Revolution. And this is the newest book in his series that began with United States of Japan and continued with Mecha Samurai Empire. This is the third standalone novel in a series that imagines a United States controlled by Japan and Germany. So alternate history. And I think that that's kind of how all the books in this series work. Each one can be read as a standalone. But this comes out March the 3rd from Ace Books. And it says, imaginative, thought-provoking, and timely. The United States of Japan series is high-concept science fiction at its best. Set in a rich universe best described as The Man in the High Castle meets Pacific Rim, the novels reimagine a world where Germany and Japan won World War II and now control the United States. And like the previous books, this one begins a brand new story arc and features new characters, making it an easy place to start for new readers. Set in an alternate 2019, Cyber Shogun Revolution follows ace mecha designer and pilot Rieko Morikawa, who is recruited to a secret organization that's plotting a revolt against the corrupt governor and Nazi sympathizer of the United States of Japan. When their plan to save the USJ from itself goes awry, the mission is saved from failure when the governor is killed by an assassin known as Bloody Mary. But Bloody Mary isn't satisfied with just the governor. All right, then. And as I said, this will be available on March the 3rd from Ace Books, Cyber Shogun Revolution. And this one is in from Macmillan. And it's a book called Stone Clock by Andrew Bannister. This is the third book in a trilogy called The Spin. The first couple of books were Creation Machine and Iron Gods, which I have showcased here on the channel before, on the mailbag. And I guess now that I have the whole thing together, I can consider reading these. Because these are, this is a trilogy that came out already. It's already come out in the UK. And so we're getting it a few years behind the times, as sometimes that happens here in the States. But this one is available a week from tomorrow, November the 19th, Stone Clock. And gosh, what can I say about these? It's, Robert J. Sawyer says it's space opera on steroids. It's been compared to Ian M. Banks by SFX. Okay, Adrian Tchaikovsky likes it, says it's fast-paced, intelligent SF, action-packed, and immersive. But it takes place in a remote star system, and it has to do with, inhabitants, the spin is dying, and its few inhabitants live unknowingly in the relative paradise of one of hundreds of virtual realities, V-realities, where they scrape a living out of remains of the real world. As the V-realities drain the less, or maybe it's V-realities, but I would hate for that to be true, because that's kind of a silly-sounding word. But anyway, as the V-realities drain the last resources of the spin, a rebellion which could kill millions sparks and gains momentum. So Stone Clock, third volume in this trilogy, looks kind of interesting. You know, I'm always up for some new space opera. And this one by Andrew Bannister, as I said, will be out November the 19th, completing the trilogy. And finally, last but far from least, a massive box full of books from the Hatchet Group. I thought this would be good to end on this week. And there's a ton of stuff in that box, and we're starting out here with Fortuna. The author is Kristen Merbeth. This book, I believe, is available now. It is the first book in something called the Nova Vita Protocol. It's being described as something designed to appeal to like people who like Becky Chambers and Catherine and Valente. Okay, I have had an e-arc of this for a couple of months now, and you know, it was one that I was considering reading for Space Opera September, but I didn't get around to it. But anyway, it's available now, and it goes like this. Fortuna launches a new space opera trilogy that will hook you from the very first crash landing. Scorpia Kaiser has always stood in the shadow of her older brother, Corvus, until the day he abandons their family to participate in a profitless war. However, becoming the heir to her mother's smuggling operation is not an easy transition for the always rebellious, usually reckless, and occasionally drunk pilot of Fortuna, an aging cargo ship and the only home Scorpia has ever known. But when Corvus returns from the war, and a deal turns deadly, Scorpia's plans to take over the family business are interrupted, and the Kaiser siblings are forced to make a choice, take responsibility for their family's involvement in a devastating massacre, or lie low and hope it blows over. Too bad Scorpia was never any good at staying out of a fight. And that is Fortuna. by Kristen Merbeth, available now from Orbit. And next, we have a book called Where Gods Fear to Go, and this is the third book in a trilogy, or at least it's a trilogy, called West of West. The author is Angus Watson, and this follows on a couple of books called You Die When You Die, very cheerful sounding, and The Land You Never Leave. So just judging by the titles and by the look of the books generally, I'm going to say this is going to be grimdark fantasy. And what can I say about it? It says, the Badlands are back, battling across the Shining Mountains. The questers discover a land more terrifying than they could ever have imagined, and they fought Thunder Lizards. All the while fighting and falling in love, the tentatively allied Owuta and Kanians must survive monster attacks, flash floods, and tornadoes to uncover the secret of the meadows. And then comes the hard part. To save themselves and everybody else, they will travel west of west, deeper into danger, and attempt to take on a goddess who has already killed all the gods. Okay. And yes, it says this is the finale of the trilogy. So Where Gods Fear to Go, from Orbit, by Angus Watson. And next up, we have another new book from Claire North, very prolific writer. This is called The Pursuit of William Abbey, and it looks fascinating. It says, from the best-selling and award-winning author of The First 15 Lives of Harry August and 84K comes a powerful new novel about how the choices we make can haunt us forever. South Africa, 1884. William Abbey, an English doctor, watches white colonists lynch a Zulu child. As the boy dies, his mother curses William. Wherever he goes, the shadow of her son will follow him. It will never stop, never rest. It can cross oceans and mountains, and if it catches him, the person he loves most in the world will die. But to those in power, William's curse might be a blessing, and as the world slides towards war, William must decide what he's willing to sacrifice in order to survive. Okay, then. Moving, thought-provoking, and utterly gripping. Claire North's stunning new novel proves again that she is one of the most original and innovative voices in modern fiction. All right, then. And I guess it is probably available this month from Orbit. And next we have Realm of Ash by Tasha Suri. This is the second book in her series called The Books of Amba. Okay. And it follows on Empire of Sand, her debut, which came out late last year, I believe. I know some folks who read that one and rather liked it. But Realm of Ash, I guess, now available. And it says, let's see, the Amban Empire is crumbling. A terrible war of succession hovers upon the horizon. The only hope for peace lies in the mysterious realm of Ash, where mortals can find what they seek in the echoes of their ancestors' dreams. But to walk there requires a steep price. All right, then. So, yeah, looks like an incredibly lush and exotic series. And I think this one is available later on this month, if not already, from Orbit. And next up, we have Down Among the Dead. This is by K.B. Wagers, and it is the second book in her series, The Farian War, following on from There Before the Chaos, which is itself following on from the Indranian trilogy. I think that that's how that's pronounced, which was K.B. Wagers' first trilogy set in this universe, and now this is a follow-on trilogy. And, Hale Bristol, former interplanetary gunrunner, Empress of Indrana. Highest value prisoner in the galaxy. So this follows on from the earlier trilogy and I guess is now available from Orbit. Now here's one of a series admittedly that I really hadn't been following, but maybe I ought to give it a look because mainly it looks like it's been military SF and not just, you know, regular space opera. But this is a book called Dominion, and it is the final volume in the Eternity War trilogy. This follows a four-book series by this author, Jamie Sawyer, called The Lazarus War. So it's just, you know, war, right? From a great many books. And so The Eternity War concludes this particular series. So the earlier series was four books, and this one is three. And I guess it is available in November from Orbit. And we're finishing up this Orbit box with a book that I have had my eyeballs on for a little while because it looks pretty fascinating to me. It's something called Queen of the Conquered. The author is Kaysen Callender, a person of color, and it's their first book, I do believe. And the name of the series is Islands of Blood and Storm. Queen of the Conquered. And so I guess this is another November, maybe December title from Orbit, but let me go ahead and read up on this one for you. It says, I want to prove to them that they were wrong to underestimate me. I want to see them burn for what they did to my family. On the islands of Hans Lolloch, Sigourney Rose was the only survivor when her family was massacred by the colonizers. Now the king of the islands has declared that he will choose his successor from among eligible noble families, and Sigourney is ready to exact her revenge. So it's a powerful story of colonialism, conquest, and revenge. Queen of the Conquered starts a riveting epic fantasy duology set in a Caribbean-inspired world. All right, then. And blurbs from Tasha Suri, Aliette de Bedard, Tochi Onyebuchi, Justina Ireland, Evan Winter, K.S. Veloso. Interesting. All right, so Queen of the Conquered, Kaysen Callender from Orbit. Let me know in the comments. So there you have it. That is what I have for the mailbag this week. Good-sized mailbag. Lots of stuff. I mean, 7 titles in that big Hatchet box alone. So, you guys know the drill. Light up those comments. Let me know which of these looks most interesting and exciting to you, and which you would like to see me prioritize for review. Otherwise, if you enjoyed watching, please hit that like button, share the video far and wide with all of your SFF reading friends. I don't think that the algorithms have been very kind to the mailbag in the last couple of months, because views are down like dramatically, like 30-40% from the usual levels. So I always appreciate it when you guys like and share and subscribe. If you haven't done so, that is how the channel grows. You can also support the channel at my TeePublic store and at my Patreon. As I mentioned before, where recruits into Wink's army get little perks like getting to see some of my videos early. I want to give those people a huge thank you for their additional support. It is extremely helpful keeping the wheels greased around here. I want to thank all the rest of you for being the very best viewers in all of BookTube. And until I see all of you next time, happy reading.